What is, I'm sorry, what is it?
Page 287.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. thankful that one came out for the service tonight. Continue to pray for those who have been sick this week or sick today. Some be better. And I text this afternoon, you wish to ask for the member reviving herself, that they're not doing well today. Let's remember those who are having surgery this week. Karen Cook's on tomorrow. Brother Glenn Christian Wednesday and Charles Armour on Thursday. Anyone else have a prayer request?
I spoke to Madison this afternoon. She has pneumonia. And she said that she feels really, really sick.
Anyone else? You have an unspoken request, I'd like to raise your hand. May we bow then and go to the Lord in prayer at this time. Go ahead and lead us in prayer.
Heavenly Father, we come to you, thank you for the day and many blessings that you've given. Thank you for giving my sins and whatever I failed you and pray, Lord, you be in our service tonight, Lord, as fast as you pray the bread of life, pray you be bring back to his mind the things he studied throughout the weekend and the messages to those of us that are saved to take them apply to our lives and those who are lost here tonight. If your Holy Spirit's burning in their heart, that they can receive Jesus Christ as their Savior. Born again, have eternal life, to us in the great word. We increase this evening that all souls will be saved and Christ blessed. Be with our missionaries, church attendants, to be with them, give them folks for their labor. Pray that you would protect them. Be with those having surgery this week, guide the surgeon's hands, give them a full recovery, bless those who give them loved ones. Comfort them, have mercy on our nation. I know that we're in a bad mess as a nation. I pray that you have your will away even the election in November. Again, give us a good service tonight and give us praise and honor, Lord. We thank you for who you are. Christ's name.
Right, let's stand and sing number 485. First and last verse. Take up an offering. 485, bottom page. Seeking who he may devour.
whom resist steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same afflictions are accomplished in your brethren that are in the world. But the God of all grace, who hath called us unto his eternal glory by Christ Jesus, after that ye have suffered a while, make you perfect, establish, strengthen, settle you. To him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. And one verse of scripture in the fourth chapter of the book of James, James 4, verse 7. Submit yourselves therefore to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Tonight I want to bring a thought that's maybe a little bit different than one would think about, and that is resisting the devil. Now, we know that the devil is no friend. He is the arch enemy of God. Satan, as he is known, is the god of this world. And men follow him. Men walk in darkness rather than light because their deeds are evil. And Satan, of course, is the one who encourages men to walk in darkness rather than have the true light of the gospel shine into their lives. So with this in mind, I'd like for us to think about tonight, as we think about resisting the devil, about four different ways that we can resist Satan, resist the devil. And they all begin with the letter P. First of all, with prayer. A prayerless life on the part of a child of God is a life that's not going to be lived well-pleasing to God. Prayer is a vital link that we have with God. That's our communication with him. And he communicates to us through his word and leads us by his spirit. And so that if you've ever tried to conduct a conversation and it was a one-way conversation, that one person or one party in that conversation was doing all the talking and the other one never said a word, it'd be very difficult, wouldn't it? And so we need to listen to what God says to us from his word. We need to avail ourselves of the opportunity to be led by the Spirit of God, God's Holy Spirit in this life. And so as we resist him with prayer, I find that Jesus said in the book of Luke in chapter 18 in verse 1, the men ought always to pray and not faint. We become weary in well-doing. Sometimes we become weary in prayer. And so Satan is one who desires to defeat us. If he can't keep us from being saved, he wants to keep us from bringing honor and glory to God. The reason he does is because he wants to grieve God every way that he possibly can. And when we pray, this gives us the strength that we need to resist Satan. In the fifth chapter of the book of 1 Thessalonians, we find that Paul said in verse 17 to pray without ceasing. Prayer puts Satan on the run. The more we pray, the less time we have to listen to Satan's devices. Believe you me, he has his bag full. And he knows just what it takes to deceive you and to deceive me. He knows just what it takes to lead us astray. He knows just what it takes to discourage us. And that's one of the greatest tools that he has in his toolbox, as it were, is that of discouragement. And when we get discouraged as the people of God, then we're not going to have the desire to really do the things that God would have us to do, because we are discouraged. And we ought to be the most upbeat, happy people in the world because we know what's going to happen out there in the future. We've read the book, my friend, and we win. We win through God. We're not going to win through Satan. We're not going to win through his devices, but we'll win through the power of Christ working in us. So, are we praying as we should? We can defeat Satan. We can resist Satan with the promises that we have from the Word of God. In 2 Peter chapter 1 and verse 4, Peter speaks of these promises. He said, "Whereby given unto us exceeding great and precious promises." Great and precious promises. And I'm thankful for the promises of God. Sometimes we sing no hymn, "Standing on the Promises of God." And they don't even stand on them. Because God's promises are eternal. God's promises are true. And God's not going to break his promises. It's impossible for God to lie. When Jesus was tempted, he used the Word of God to defeat the devil. He resisted the devil by claiming the promises of God. And remember when Satan tempted him out in the desert or in the wilderness, that he came to him personally and tempted him. Well, we've already read that he's as a roaring lion. And I don't know how he appeared in the presence of Jesus, but we're taught in the Word of God he was the most beautiful angel that God created. And, of course, that we think of his personality as being that of a man's personality when we read the Word of God. But Satan is a spirit. But Satan is not omnipresent. Only the Holy Spirit of God is omnipresent. In that his spirit can be everywhere at one time. He can meet with us here at Snow Road. He can meet with God's people in another local body down the road. He can be in many services tonight. We'd be in a predicament if we had to all meet at a different time in order for the Holy Spirit to meet with us. Satan doesn't have the ability. That's why he needs all those demons to help him, to be his little assistants. And he uses them to his advantage, not to your advantage and not to my advantage. But when Jesus was being tempted of Satan, and Jesus had not had anything to eat or drink for days on end, he said, "Command these stones be turned into bread." Jesus said, "It is written." He quoted in Scripture, "It is written, thou shalt not live by bread alone, but by every word which proceedeth out of the mouth of the Father." So you and I don't live by bread alone. We live with the promises that God has given us. So we need to remember that we are to resist him through the promises that God has given us in his word. I just read one in James 4:7, how that if we'll resist him, that he'll flee from us. But I feel like today that we're living in an age and a time when there's not much resistance against Satan. That he's being allowed to make inroads into the things of God. And of course, one day, God's going to have the ultimate victory over him. There's no question about that. As I said a while ago, I read the book and I know how it ends. I know one day he's going to meet his ultimate demise. One day he's going to be cast in to the lake of fire and brimstone. He's going to suffer through eternity for his rebellion against God. with all unbelievers who are cast into the lake of fire. If you're here tonight and you're an unbeliever, you're not trusting Jesus as your Savior. If you don't trust Him as your Savior, you know what? You go and spend eternity with Him, with Satan. He's probably not going to be very easy to live with through eternity. But if we resist the devil, we're promised that he will flee from us. If we resist the devil as we should, or do we give in to his devices? You know, one of the greatest examples that I find in the Old Testament of a young man resisting the devil was when Joseph was in the house of Potiphar, and Potiphar's wife tried to seduce him, and he ran out of the house. And the Bible teaches us to flee temptation, to get away from it. To run away if we have to. But as I said this morning, sometimes our spiritual strength is not up to par. And we're not as strong physically as we need to be sometimes. And when we're not up to par physically, we may not feel like running, literally. Think about the old song that they sing about the childhood days. When I was just a child, I could climb the hillside all day long. What's a little special on Dauphin Island here not long ago? And I'm reminded, one of the first things I remember as a child, one of the first times I ever went to Dauphin Island, was the sand dunes. Man, I'd get up there and I could run up those sand, up and down those sand dunes like it was nothing. I doubt I could make it to the top of one of them now. If I did, somebody probably had to bring me down. I can't do what I used to do. Time has made a change, amen, to those of us who are senior citizens. And that we can't do what we did many times as a child because these bodies do wear out. But then, when we stand on the promises of God, we can be sure that Satan is going to flee. The next one is that we need to resist him with perseverance. Perseverance is a long word with many letters in it. But this means action or condition of persevering, steadfastness, following through to the ultimate victory. And many Christians fail to resist Satan because they do not continue in a persistent effort to do so. If a runner, you know, I was driving down Old Shell Road the other day, and I don't know whether these young guys were from South Alabama, where they were from St. Paul's, and one of the schools on Old Shell Road. Could have been Spring Hill College, I don't know. But looked like maybe that they were running, probably going to be on the track team or football team or something, but they were running down the sidewalks. There were several of them. And it was pretty hot that day. It was up in the 90s, and I thought about as they were perspiring and they were running down through there that they're doing that. And they're persevering, they're being persistent so that they might be able to accomplish the goal that they have for themselves and for their team when that time comes. And to build endurance that they were out there running. Now, it takes endurance to be able to resist Satan. He is a formidable foe. He's stronger than any of us. And that many times that he comes to us unaware. You've heard of somebody approach you on your blind side? Satan loves to do that. Come up and hit you at a time when you least expect it. And you might get up one morning and say, well, like the song says, I'm feeling mighty fine. And you get up and say, well, everything's going to go wonderful today. First news you know, bam, Satan hits you unexpectedly. Your flowers begin to wilt. Your courage begins to wane. Well, what are we to do in these circumstances? In the 15th chapter of the book of 1 Corinthians, Paul made a statement in verse 58. Be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. For as much as you know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord, there's sometimes and in some situations that we labor in this life, that it's in vain, that it doesn't count for anything. But he said, our labor will not be in vain for the Lord. He's keeping account in heaven. We all have that heavenly bank account as children of God. No one else can draw on your account. You know, someone can steal your identity and draw out your funds from the bank. But no one can steal your identity with God, because God knows who you are. You're His. And He's not going to be deceived, and He's not going to be fooled. Kind of like one time, I don't remember the exact situation that it was, but I believe maybe that it was, I was in the Social Security office one day. I believe it was the surrounding. And a man came in to draw his Social Security. Sign up for his Social Security. They said, do you have your birth certificate? And he said, no, ma'am. Said, I believe he didn't have one. You know, way back yonder, before, when people lived way out in the sticks and children were born in the home, and maybe a midwife delivered them or something, that a lot didn't have a birth certificate, and they just recorded in the family Bible. They didn't even have a family Bible with them. And she said, well, you have to prove that you were born. He said, ma'am, I wouldn't be standing here if I had not been born. So, people can be fooled, but God cannot. And then we resist Him with praise. In Psalm 113 in verse 3, the psalmist said, from the rising of the sun until the going down of the same, the Lord's name is to be praised. Sun up to sundown. My wife and I received the little weekly newspaper from Georgia County, Mississippi, printed in Loosedale, every week, and have since Pastor Howell Church many years ago. And this is kind of the way we keep up with some of our friends and people that we've known down through the years in Georgia County, because I pastored several churches in that area down through the years. And I kind of like to know what's going on over there from time to time. And there's an article in there this past week about a little post office / grocery store that used to be in the Bendale community. They said they didn't have regular hours. Their hours were from can to can. And I've heard a lot of wives make that same statement. They don't have regular work hours like my husband does. He goes to work, works 8 hours, and comes home. I said, I work from can to can, taking care of him and these children, and doing household chores and so on. But he said, from the rising of the sun and the going down of the same, his name is to be praised. In other words, from the time that we get out of bed to the time that we return to the bed at night, we're to praise his name. And we have something to be thankful for. We have something to praise his name for. You know, most Christians do not praise the name of the Lord enough. Some Christians fail to praise the Lord because they're too involved with other pursuits and endeavors. They're caught up with the things of this life and fail to give God the honor and glory that they should. If we're too busy as children of God to honor him and praise him in our lives, we're just simply too busy. Sometimes we can get overloaded in this life. We have too many things going on, and it can hinder us in our service to God. So we must take time for God. We must take time to praise him. It doesn't cost us anything to praise him insofar as giving up material possessions in this life would be concerned. But it will cost us in the way of spiritual blessings if we fail to praise him as we should. To praise the Lord will mean that we'll gain the ultimate victory over Satan. Many receive the praise and accolades of their fellow man. And I don't know about you, but I've just about had enough politics for this year. Somebody asked me the other day, did I watch the DNC? I said, not a minute of it. I already got burned out. I'm tired of all those lies that these politicians tell. But I can go to God's Word and I can find the truth. I can walk in the truth. In Psalm 146, I'm going to read two verses of Scripture. Praise ye the Lord. Praise the Lord, O my soul. While I live, will I praise the Lord. It'd be too late to praise him when these old bodies go to the grave. You know, when I draw my last breath and the funeral director embalms my body, places it in the casket, and it's rolled into whatever church that I have my funeral in, that I won't be able to praise the Lord in that condition. I won't be able to say a word. I won't be able to open an eye. I won't be able to breathe one breath. So while we live, we need to praise the Lord. I will sing praises unto my God while I have any being. While there's any life in me, while I have any being, that I will praise the Lord. And Satan certainly does not enjoy hearing God's people praise him. Are we resisting Satan as we should? There's a law that governs, and God placed all these things into existence. And when you stop for a moment and you think about all the things that take place for the planets to be in their orbits, for the Earth to be in its orbit, it rotates, it revolves. There's a thing that I believe his name is Sir Isaac Newton, discovered, and it's called gravity. It's been said that what goes up must come down. You walk outside, you throw a ball up in there, it's going to come down somewhere. It's not just going to take off out into space and never come back. If we had no gravity, you know what? We'd all be hanging off the ceiling. If we walked out the door, we'd just take off up in the air. If there was no gravity. So God knew what he was doing when he placed gravity here. He knows just the exact speed for this earth to turn, for the gravity to hold us on this earth. You know, the ancient explorers, many of them felt that the earth was flat. And they were afraid to sail too far because they were afraid they'd sail off the edge of the world. But then they finally discovered that the earth was round. But God placed all these things into existence. There has to be resistance to Satan in order for you and I to be overcomers as children of God. Are you resisting him as you should, child of God? Am I resisting him as I should? Well, probably not. I was made 100 on that. You have, congratulations. But instead of just accepting what he's doing and not attempting to resist him, we need to resist him all the days of our lives. I hear so much today about, well, that's just the way it is today. In other words, just give up, just let Satan have his way. And that falls on the heading, political expediency. We're not hurting someone's feelings. As I've said many times, I don't go around intentionally wanting to or desiring to hurt people's feelings. I want to be a blessed person. But then there comes a time when, if we don't resist Satan, that we're not doing our job as children of God. Now let's look at the other side for just a moment. If you never trusted Christ as your Savior, what are you doing about the Satan question? What are you going to do with him? Are you going to allow him to string you out? You get to the place that your heart becomes hardened through the deceitfulness of sin. And the Spirit of the Lord doesn't deal with you anymore. That's what Satan wants to do. He wants to string you out till you get to the place that it doesn't bother you anymore to hear the gospel message. It doesn't bother you anymore when someone would witness to you. It doesn't trouble you anymore with thoughts of hell. But Satan would have you to believe, well, if I go to hell, I'll have plenty of company. Well, you sure will, but you're not going to enjoy it. Sinner, are you resisting Satan? But you don't have the power to overcome him without the power of God. And the only way that you can have the power of God in your life trust Jesus as your Savior. No man can come unto the Father except the Spirit draw him. And we can't come to God unless we come through Christ. In John chapter 1, verses 11 and 12, we're told that he came unto his own, that is, unto the lost sheep of Israel. He came unto his own, and his own received him not. His own people. But as many as did receive him, to them gave he what? Power to become the sons of God. You can't become a child of God without the power of the Lord. It's not a matter of being a flip-flop. It's a matter of turning it over to the Lord and letting him take control. So, would you resist Satan and follow in the loving arms of Jesus Christ? Let him save you. We're going to have a verse of a song. We have this song. Anything be on your heart tonight, you come as we stand and sing.